went to his parents' house and I thought nothing of it. I was in a sweatshirt and leggings, just thought we were hanging out.
And she was upset because she could have gone home and visited him instead of, you know, just sitting there. So she was all worried and, you know, not in a very good mood. And I so badly just wanted to be like, just relax, you're about to get engaged, but obviously couldn't. So battled the storm for about 3 hours. She settled down a little bit.
And on the deck, drinking a beer with my dog, and next thing I know, my mom's walking through the door, and then her boyfriend Doug, and then my dad walks through the door, and then my brother walks through the door. And I'm just, the video of me screaming, "What's going on? What's going on?" And then he walked up and said something adorable that I think was something like, "This day, I wanted to make this day special. It wasn't what we had planned, but I wanted you to remember it." And that's when he got down. I stood up then, realizing that something was happening. And he got down on one knee, and that's when he asked me to marry him.
And once her family walked out onto the back deck and saw all of her family together, she really didn't know what was going on. And then that's when I went ahead, turned around, got on a knee, and asked her to marry me.
But I had absolutely no idea. He had brought all my family in, which was insanely special because my brother lives in Texas. My parents are not together, but they both live in Northwest Indiana. And so he knew that that was like such a special moment, and to get everyone together in the same room is like nearly impossible. So yeah, the ordinary day went from like one of the most special days ever.
There's a verse in Isaiah that says that people that believe in God, even their dark days should be as bright as the noonday sun. And my prayer for you and my toast to you, Kelly, is that even your dark days, you and Adams, are as bright as the noonday sun.
Yeah. I would say that I'm madly in love with you. I'm honored to be your wife, become your wife today, and I can't wait to see where our journey goes.
Kelly, I just love you more than you could ever know. You have been my backbone through thick and thin, and I cannot wait to spend the rest of my life with you. You are truly amazing. And I cannot thank you enough for the day that you have put together today. And you look beautiful. And I love you.
One day far from now, we'll see it written in the sky. If we don't live forever, it's alright. 'Cause we were stars tonight.
Yeah, you muted a spin?
You made it.
It's on.
I have no idea. You look beautiful.
You look amazing. Get your white shoes.
I know.
Like some stuff.
Go ahead, turn around.
I got a train.
Stunning.
I was doing muscles inside.
Why?
Because I was like...
doing some party pumps?
Thank you.
I know.
It's turning out to be a very, very, very nice bet.
Good.
Yeah. Me too.
You do a spin.
Me?
Yeah.
So you ready?
I have something for you. Regile is what it says.
Muhammad Ali boxing glove.
Why is that here? Why is that here?
My man cave is complete. Until I find the next thing.
Hey, Kelly, let's get it done.
Thank you. Okay. Welcome, everyone, in the name of God and His Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dearly beloved, we are assembled in the sight of God to join together this man and this woman in the bonds of marriage, which is an honorable estate instituted of God. Therefore, I charge you each and both before the great God, the searcher of all hearts, be well assured that all those who are brought together according to the word of God are joined together of God. Everyone can please be seated. Scott, who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I do.
Thank you, brother.
To start this thing off, we're going to have a reading performed by two friends of the bride, Samantha and Jacqueline, and it is called The Art of Marriage.
Happiness in marriage is not something that just happens. A good marriage must be created. In the art of marriage, the little things are the big things.
It is never being too old to hold hands. It is remembering to say, I love you, at least once a day. It is never going to sleep angry.
It is at no time taking the other for granted. The courtship should not end with the honeymoon. It should continue through all the years.
It is having a mutual sense of values and common objectives. It is standing together facing the world. It is forming a circle of love that gathers in the whole family.
It is doing things for each other, not in the attitude of duty or sacrifice, but in the spirit of joy. It is speaking words of appreciation and demonstrating gratitude in thoughtful ways.
It is not looking for perfection in each other. It is cultivating flexibility, patience, understanding, and a sense of humor.
It is having the capacity to forgive and forget. It is giving each other an atmosphere in which each can grow.
It is finding room for the things of the spirit. It is a common search for the good and the beautiful.
It is establishing a relationship in which the independence is equal, dependence is mutual, and the obligation is reciprocal.
It is not only marrying the right partner, it is being the right partner. It is discovering what marriage can be at its best.
Thank you. In light of Adam and Kelly's Christian faith, they wanted this to be a Christian ceremony. And so they asked me to share for just a couple of minutes. And I'm going to start that sharing off with a passage of scripture from Ephesians chapter 5. And if you've ever been to a wedding before, you've probably heard it, but I'm going to read it anyway. It starts off, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved his church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does for the church, and we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife like he loves himself, and the wife sees that she respects her husband. A wedding is a special and a remarkable event because in the ceremony, it establishes and it celebrates the covenant of marriage. Marriage is an ancient covenant. It's one that was instituted by God at the very outset of human history itself. In the book of Genesis, we read that God first made man, and when he looked upon the man, he saw something that he delighted in. Lost my spot there for a minute. Something that was good. The man was good and God delighted in him. But he also saw something else. He saw that it was not good for his man to be alone. And so not long after God created man, it says that he put the man to sleep, and out of the very flesh of the man, he brought forth a woman. This was to be man's partner, his companion, his dwelling mate, and perhaps most importantly, his friend, for all of his days on the earth. It's easy to say that God made a woman for all types of reasons, that the man was lonely and needful of companionship, that there was too much work for the man to do all by himself. You could say that he made woman for reproductive purposes, right? Because you can't get two out of just one person. But the truth of the matter is that God made woman primarily and foremost for a specific reason. That without someone or something to love and to give himself for, man would be unable to fulfill his role of being made in the image and likeness of God. See, we often think that marriage is a covenant of convenience, that it's you scratch my back and I'll scratch your back. Often we think that it's for the sake of having offspring. That's not to be excluded. That's an awfully important part of the man-woman relationship. But the point is that marriage in and of itself is not, or was never meant to be, a selfish endeavor. When you agree to join with another in marriage, what you are agreeing to is not simply to be there for someone when they need you. It goes way deeper than that. What you are saying is that I will absolutely and definitively, with as much as lies within me and with every conscious effort in my mind, put you before me. And so marriage is not a covenant of convenience. It's far from it. You are essentially offering up your life as a sacrifice for someone else. Marriage is the giving of yourself to and for another person. It is the laying down of your life, regardless of if that means the betterment of your life or not. So, Adam and Kelly, in light of that, we all bid you God's best, and may you always find the strength to make yourselves dependent on God, helplessly dependent on God, in order to love one another well with everything that lies within you. And may you always keep him first and foremost at the center of your union with one another. In doing this, you will find that your love and commitment to one another will be far greater, far richer, and far more overwhelming in years to come than it ever has been, even up until this point. So, to close, from Corinthians 13, this is a request of the bride, but it's a good verse. If I speak with the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil. Love rejoices in the truth. Love always